This great big story is made possible by Lexus. Experience amazing.
The Harvard Brain Bank is one of the largest brain banks in the country. At the moment, we house approximately 5,000 brain specimens. My name is Sabina Beretta. I am the scientific director of the Harvard Brain Tissue Resource Center, which we affectionately call Harvard Brain Bank. Our mission is to collect brain specimens, store them, characterize them, and then redistribute them out to investigators across the world. They do research on the human brain, and in particular on large number of neurological and psychiatric brain disorders, such as schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, Parkinson, Huntington, and many others. The Brain Bank never sleeps. We have two sets of people that are on call 24/7. We have a very limited time window from when the person passes away to the time we need to be done with this whole processing.
So this is going to be your first brain late at night, right?
I know, first late night brain.
We have to do it in less than 24 hours. Our courier will bring it to McLean Hospital, to the Brain Bank.
So just put it out here, so we're going to take ourselves.
There will be a dissectionist ready to dissect the brain. That involves separating the two hemispheres. One of the two hemispheres is put in a solution that preserves it. The other hemisphere will be dissected in thick sections, and those will be frozen. We are not even close to understand a lot of what we take for granted. Our thoughts, our instincts, our feelings, our emotions. There are a lot of questions we still don't know, and a lot of our brain functions still will probably be studied for a long time to come. A brain donation is, in a very concrete way, a gift of knowledge, and it cannot be done without the help of families and people willing to donate their brain.
Give me a hug. Give me a hug. Yes, I know.
Okay, you want to do some training?
I work with dogs to train them to go into an MRI scanner and try to figure out what makes them tick and what they're thinking. My name is Gregory Burns. I'm a neuroscientist at Emory University in Atlanta, Georgia. I've grown up with dogs and I've lived with dogs pretty much my whole life. One of my favorite dogs had passed away. In the back of my mind, I started wondering, did that dog love me in the way that I loved him? And that was really the beginning of it. All of these basic things that we've begun to sort out in humans, at least in human brains, we want to do in dogs. If dogs can be trained to go into an MRI machine, then maybe we could figure out what they're actually thinking. So we have a dog in the scanner, that's Katie, and she is a veteran of the project. This is probably about the 15th time she's done this. Just having the idea of, okay, well, let's train dogs to go in the scanner, it wasn't immediately apparent how you would go about doing that. And MRI scanners are not the most pleasant environments.
Callie, coil, good girl.
Callie is the little black terrier who was the first dog to train for the dog project.
High five.
I built a simulator of an MRI. So this is the simulator that I built here in my basement. Then we started adding in recordings of the scanner noise, which is actually quite loud. We just started working with, you know, treats and positive reinforcement to see if we could get her to go into this thing. That actually proved to be pretty easy. And then so what we did was we kind of put out word of mouth, do you want to join this project? Do you want to train your dogs for an MRI and, you know, maybe figure out what they're thinking? The purpose of this is to go through a number of exercises, including basic obedience, as well as how they react to the obstacles. When we hold the tryouts, it lets us weed out the dogs that we don't think would enjoy doing this. One of the benefits then of having more participants is it gives you statistical power. You can start to average dogs' brains together and get a better sense for what's happening. I started wondering very seriously if we could really finally answer this question. Do dogs essentially like us just for the social bond and not about the food?
Good boy.
And what we found was looking at the reward system that almost all the dogs had equal responses both to food as well as praise. And even a few dogs like the praise more. The things that we were finding about the dog's brain in many ways confirm, I think, what people know in their hearts about how dogs behave and why they behave. And the way I think about dogs is in many ways they're the ambassadors to the animal world. They're not that different from many of the other mammals out there, and so I suspect that a lot of what we find in dogs probably holds true for pretty much any mammal.
Have you ever walked out of a building on a sunny day and had an uncontrollable urge to sneeze? If you answered yes, like me, you likely suffer from a strange genetic condition that has remained unexplained by medical science for millennia. And if you answered no, you probably have no idea what I'm talking about. Sun sneezing, as it's more commonly known, is a medical condition called the photic sneeze reflex.
Another name that some have given is...
Hold on. Before we get into all that, this is Dr. Louis Potacek, a neurologist and human geneticist at the University of California, San Francisco. Okay, go ahead.
Another name that some have given is autosomal dominant compelling helio-ophthalmic outburst, or Achu syndrome. But PSR is really the appropriate name that we should all use. Photic sneeze reflex is a tendency to sneeze when suddenly exposed to bright light.
And as strange as that may sound, it's more common than you might think.
I estimate that about 1 in 10, or 10% of all people, have this condition.
So a lot of us are affected, but how and why it happens is not fully understood, despite the fact that humans have been pondering it
for thousands of years.
In 350 BC, Aristotle posed the question, why does the heat of the sun provoke sneezing? Aristotle was barking up the wrong tree, though.
This doesn't make sense because heat in and of itself doesn't cause sneezing.
Some 2,000 years later, the philosopher Sir Francis Bacon also tried to figure it out. His theory was that light from the sun caused your eyes to water, which then seeped into your nose, triggering a sneeze.
It's an interesting thought, but it doesn't make a lot of sense. PSR occurs almost instantaneously, and it takes longer for the tear ducts to react. Furthermore, tears don't cause sneezing. There's no evidence for that.
So modern medicine has come up with its own theories, and it has to do with the wiring in your head.
Sneezes are triggered typically by irritating things in our nose. And these are detected by a nerve, the trigeminal nerve.
And right next door to the trigeminal nerve is the optic nerve. You may have heard of this one.
The optic nerve is stimulated by bright light and sends electric signals to the brain. Some of that signal can be picked up by the trigeminal nerve and misinterpreted by the brain as an irritation in the nose.
Which triggers, you guessed it, a sneeze. Well, that's the theory anyway.
Photic sneeze reflex is not a disease. Consequently, the medical community hasn't paid a whole lot of attention to it. Therefore, we know very little about what causes it.
But Dr. Potacek believes that understanding PSR could potentially shed some light on more serious conditions.
Epileptic seizures can be caused by strobing lights. Migraine headache is precipitated by light. If we can understand what the mechanism is that leads to PSR, this may give insights into other conditions which actually are medically important and represent disorders.
So there you have it. This 2,000-year-old medical mystery may be worth solving after all.
Imagine remembering every single day of your life, all in perfect detail. For those with highly superior autobiographical memory, or HSAM for short, this is their reality.
I remember everything that's personally happened to me since I was born.
That's Rebecca Sharrock. I was fascinated by this condition, so I called her up to find out more.
Hi, Rebecca.
Hi.
How are you going?
Oh, I'm doing all right. It's a very wet Saturday morning here. How are you going?
Side note, in this moment, I just realized Rebecca will remember that this day was a wet morning forever.
So you remember everything in great detail?
People can remember what they did last Saturday, but I can remember what I did Saturday 10 years ago.
What about a memory from when you were just a baby?
When I was 12 days old, I was lying down on the fur car seat in my parents' car, and I was staring up at the steering wheel, and I thought, what is that?
Rebecca is one of only 60 people worldwide to have been identified with having HSAM.
All through my teenage years, I thought that everybody remembered in this kind of way. I thought it was completely normal.
It wasn't until she was 21 when her parents decided to submit her to the University of California to undergo 2 years of testing. After this, she was officially identified as having HSAM. Since memories can come to mind unexpectedly any time of day, a negative memory like this can make living with HSAM difficult.
Mum was putting me in this itchy satin dress and I was crying because I didn't like it. And Mum gave me this Minnie Mouse toy and I couldn't say anything at the time, but her face terrified me.
But on most days, HSAM is a gift. Rebecca can recall happy memories and moments when times get tough.
A good memory, it makes me so thankful about having this kind of HSAM memory.
Thanks for chatting, Rebecca.
Yep, thanks. Bye.